This Steve Jones Show podcast is now loading. The Steve Jones Show podcast is presented by Sunbury Motor Company, Purdy Insurance, Brewers Outlet, and NIL Game Changers. Bringing you an in-depth look at Penn State sports and more. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. The Steve Jones Show is presented by Sunbury Motor Company, Purdy Insurance, Brewers Outlet, and NIL Game Changers. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Thursday afternoon edition of the Steve Jones Show here on News Radio 1070 AM WKOK, sponsored by Purdy Insurance, Brewers Outlet, and NIL Game Changers, along with Sunbury Motors. We are currently in the Sunbury Motors studio here in Sunbury. Got a fun show today. Matt Cotrillo is calling in at 1:15. I'm sure he's wound up about some things. Maybe if it's still me and him, I'll get him to tell us a little bit about his 24-23 softball game on Tuesday he broadcast, which sounds like it was both fun and long, very long. And then about 2:35, John Sauber from the Center Daily Times is going to join us to get a little his perspective on spring practice and Saturday's blue-white game. And that's where Steve's at right now. They had a quarterback club this afternoon. He mentioned it yesterday, I believe. And not back from Haluba Hall yet, and quarterback club for the blue-white game, which takes place on Saturday. I believe they go on the air at 1:45. Kick is at 2 o'clock, and the game will be televised on the Big Ten Network at 2 o'clock. So if you can't make it out to Beaver Stadium for the blue-white game, it does sound like once this storm clears out today tonight that it should be pretty good, pretty decent weather for the blue-white game Saturday, and it'll be a chance for fans to check out some of the things that we've been talking about on the podcast or on the radio. What's the offense? I mean, you're not going to get a giant, a wide variety of the new offense and the new defense, but it is a chance to see what, some of the things that Andy Koltynicki is looking to do offensively and Tom Allen. How Tom Allen's going to deploy some of those pieces in the Penn State defense, kind of, be fans' first chance to see Abdul Carter at his new position at defensive end instead of linebacker. Going to be interesting to see how Bo Prabula mixes in at the quarterback now with this new system. If you guys got a chance to watch Kansas the last couple years, you know that Andy is if the quarterback can move, he's not afraid to run the quarterback. So be interesting to see if there's some plays for Bo in the new system this season. What else is going on? We talked a lot about this week about the college basketball and things of that. Zach Edey won the Wooden Award last night. I don't think that's any great surprise. Second straight year. First big man to repeat since Ralph Sampson back in the early 80s when he played at Virginia. So, I don't think that's a big surprise, and I don't think there's a lot of arguments to be made that Zach didn't deserve another Player of the Year award. So why don't we get into this first break? We'll have Matt back on here at 1:15. You're listening to the Steve Jones Show here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Spring has sprung, and it's time to dust off those insurance policies. For over 100 years, the Purdy Insurance Agency has been protecting families and businesses of the greater Susquehanna Valley and beyond. With the experience of our trained and knowledgeable staff, you can rest assured that your needs will be evaluated and met by some of the industry's best representatives. No matter what your insurance needs are, call Purdy Insurance today at 570-286-5855 or visit our website at purdyinsurance.com to see what we can do for you.
Party time, game time, or just fun time. Doesn't matter what time it is, because it's Brewers Outlet time. The Beverage Supermarket has the area's largest beer selection, imports, microbrews, ciders, and domestics. Pick from over 100 ice-cold 12-packs and dozens of 24-ounce singles. Soda, snacks, hot sauces, fresh roasted peanuts. Make it one-stop party shopping, and don't forget the pickle bar. So whatever you're celebrating or just doing it up, Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street, Sunbury, wants to see you. And thank you for your years of patronage.
Welcome back to the Steve Jones Show here on News Radio 1070 WKOK. I am Todd Hummel. You are listening to us here in the Sunbury Motors studio here in Sunbury, and we have got Mr. Matt Cotrillo on the line for 2 days late for your weekly rants?
Yeah, 2 days late this week. It's been a busy week for me. We had back-to-back games Tuesday and yesterday. Tuesday was the aforementioned 10-inning, 24-23 game at Central Columbia, as you well know, Todd. So it's been a bit of a crazy week, but I'm here now, and I'm glad to be back.
Well, I was going to say, you sure it just wasn't one game over 2 days?
It was starting to feel like that, no doubt. It was officially a 3 hour, 32-minute game.
Oh my God! You didn't have to. At least you didn't have to fill time for a 3 hour and 30-minute rain delay, I guess, right?
Well, yeah, we would have, but luckily it was all just from straight up regulation / extra inning play. There was no rain involved. It was a beautiful day on Tuesday. That was really the one silver lining.
Actually, I think the best part of the whole story is you guys had to get a hold of the guide company to make a wider spot so you could show the replay.
Yes, exactly right, because it was pretty unprecedented. That was one of our longest broadcasts we have. The last one we had was because of the lightning delay when we had our first football broadcast of the year two years ago when Milton opened up the newly renovated alumni field and everybody got delayed that night with a massive thunderstorm that came through the area.
My friend, I was up at Berwick for Berwick and Southern that night, and I didn't get out of Crispin Field till after 11. So,
yeah,
I feel your pain.
So, but at least there's something there with that. When it comes to, I'm going to start because the Masters, of course, is now underway, as you know, Todd Hummel. And that if Steve has not talked about this with you before, you'll get a load of it now. I was a very very big critic, the leading critic of one Greg Norman when the whole Live PGA back and forth was happening. But now they've merged, and of course Greg Norman wasn't invited to the Masters last year when the whole Live PGA thing was going on, and which I was fully for, because I thought what Greg Norman was doing was destroying the game at that point in time. And And obviously, for me, from a moral standpoint, I thought it was pretty disgraceful what he was doing. But it is what it is. So he's still not allowed back at the Masters, from what I can tell. So he's there. He's there as a ticketed patron. And he was quoted in a couple stories yesterday saying, "I'm just here to support 10 of my 13 golfers that are Masters champs, and I let them know that the boss is here." And I stopped for a second. What boss? You're not their boss anymore. They've merged. Where have you been? I'll tell you where he's been. He's been in nowhere's land, finishing at just short, like his entire playing career was, including at Augusta. And he's just trying to live in his own fantasy world like he's had it his entire career, both as a player and an owner, if you can even go wherever he is now with Liv. They're merged now. You're no longer a boss. Get over yourself. Liv Golf didn't work. They tried to make it cute and maybe get a TV. You got half a TV deal with the CW of all places. It didn't work. So you merged. It's fine. The PGA still lives. It is what it is. That's the way things are. Get over yourself, Greg Norman, and just shut your mouth and watch the tournament or get out.
Well, I think one of the reasons he's not allowed back is they aren't actually merged yet.
Oh, yeah, they're still working on it, but it looks like it will get done probably within this next year or so. But regardless, the whole live, this whole live idea project is done. It's over. Because they're eventually going to get merged, it looks like, at least for right now. As of doing this show right now on Thursday, April 11th, it looks like they will be merged. So, therefore, he's no boss man. He's just a regular old jabroni that's just there watching the Masters.
I understand the hate of Greg Norman, but he's just a means to an end. He's just, if he wouldn't have done it, they would have gotten another older golfer that everybody knew. It'd probably be Jack Nicklaus in that spot trying to get everybody to the live. He's a mean to the end for the Saudis to get themselves involved in golf, and they did, and they threw their money at it, and now they're going to end up, you know, if they do merge, they're going to be the ones that own the PGA Tour, not the PGA Tour.
Well, that is true, but it's still not going to be Greg Norman leading the way with this thing. I mean, what the PGA did also, to be fair, I thought was also disgraceful and distasteful when they finally gave in, because I guess they realized that things are kind of slipping on their end too. Just this whole thing to me is destroying the game, and it's only really going to, I guess, I can't say it's going to get worse, because I think it's already hit a rock bottom, but there's always going to be that stain there when it comes to golf, when it comes to this back and forth and looks like possible merger between LIV and PGA. It's just annoying.
Yeah, you're old enough to know now, realize that money outweighs morals almost all the time.
Unfortunately, yes.
And
there's no question there.
And at this point, I think right now it's, you know, the PGA, if the PGA Tour wants to survive and LIV wants to survive, they have to figure out a way to come together, just because the TV ratings obviously reflect that. And you know, we had Jerry Dulac on the show yesterday, and he and Steve both made the point that this is, you know, these fields aren't very good in the PGA Tour right now. You haven't heard a lot of the winners, you know, other than the Players Championship and the three wins that Scottie Scheffler has. And there's going to be there's going to come a time where, you know, this last wave of stars, Tiger Woods and Rory and Phil, are going to be gone, and somebody's going to have to fill that void, and they're going to have to figure that out before we get to that point.
Yeah, I mean, that's a really good point by both of them. And you know, I'm just looking at the leaderboard now. I know we're early, but I don't know who any of these people are that are there right now, except maybe Danny Willett and DeChambeau. Other than that, I have no clue who any of these people are. Like I said, we still have some tee-offs happening a little bit later with some of the big names, but I think you just look at the field right now, that's a pretty good example of it.
Yeah, and to be, like you said, to be fair, I think most of the bigger names tee off a little later, and I don't think they were supposed to start at like 7:30, and the weather was bad enough that the first group didn't tee off till almost after 10, I think. So they're a little behind right now.
Correct. Yes. Well, this leads me now to my next point here, my next gripe of the week, and Adam Silver. Now, as I've mentioned before on the show, I think he's the best commissioner out of all four major sports commissioners. But I thought his biggest critic is how he's handled Draymond Green and his antics. To me, the NBA is just being an enabler of his erratic behavior, and to me, dangerous behavior of the NBA that's affecting the game right now and their own players. So He goes after Jontay Porter, who they're investigating for the gambling issue, as they should be. I'm not trying to disparage that at all. And he calls it a cardinal sin as the league continues that investigation there of Jontay Porter. Again, that's not wrong at all. He's exactly right. It is a cardinal sin. But here's another cardinal sin he should be pursuing a little bit more, and that is what Draymond Green is doing. This guy should also be a lifetime ban right now. How many chances is this guy going to get for all of his off-the-court and on-the-court antics, especially on the court when you're stepping on guys' chests and other parts of the body, you're going after officials, you're going after fans, you're mouthing off this way and that? I mean, the fact that he got either it was either 25 game suspension or a little less than that after what happened in Sacramento earlier in the year. I mean, that was the, to me, that was it for me. That was the final straw that this league is a complete enabler of Draymond Green's erratic behavior. And the fact that he went out and said this is a cardinal sin, which again isn't necessarily wrong in this case because it's gambling on the NBA, but when you have a guy that's attacked, literally attacking your own players, your own officials, your own coaches, your own league in general, and you don't call him a cardinal sin, and you aren't trying to rapidly try to get him out of the game, there's something wrong with that. I'm sorry.
Boy, are you young. Draymond Green is minor in the history of the NBA of people that have been awful, man.
I mean, I get it. I mean, after watching the Last Dance, I mean, that was obviously quite educational for me. I knew some things, but a lot of blanks were filled in then. I get it, but I would definitely have probably would have said the same things about guys like Dennis Rodman, etc. But the way things are, but in the current state of the NBA today, yeah, Draymond Green needs to go. I've had enough of him.
I'd love to see your reaction to the bad boy Pistons and Rick Mahorn between the Pistons and then when he came to the Sixers, my man. You never hated a player more and then loved a player more than when Rick Mahorn came from the Pistons to the Sixers.
When the whole Ron Artest big fight happened, the malice at the Palace, when that happened with the Pacers and the Pistons, I hated everybody on those teams too.
Well, that's a whole different story. That's an outlier, obviously, in the last 50 years is the malice at the Palace. But, I get it. It is a different NBA now than it was in the 80s and 90s, and I understand why people get wound up about Draymond, and I understand some of the stuff. And I don't know if you saw this. Did you see? I think it was earlier in the week that Klay Thompson was on his podcast, and he wanted Klay to tell him honestly what they think when he gets thrown out. And it was... You know, it's kind of the feeling you would think that they would have, that they do get upset about it. They do, because basically Klay's point is we are not the Golden State Warriors without you on the floor. Like, we won 3 championships with you. You're a main cog. You do all the little things. And when you're not out there, we're not whole. And you can tell when he doesn't play. And I get the antics are obnoxious, but I think the bigger deal for him is exactly what Klay says, is he needs to be on the floor for that team. There's not many guys that size that have carved out a career in the NBA as an inside player, as the kind of player that he's been. And it's just, and it is kind of sad that his antics are his career is more reflected in his antics than in what kind of basketball player he actually is.
I did see that, and I thought Klay Thompson was spectacular, and I think more of his teammates should be doing that. I think Steph Curry, correct me if I'm wrong, might have even was asked about that too, and he kind of either shown or voiced some sort of indirect displeasure with him too. So, yeah, they should be, and they should be calling him out for it. There's no question. I would.
I don't understand how he's – you'd think he'd give it a couple weeks just because of having to go through therapy and proving that at least it worked for a little bit, and I don't think it did.
No, and nothing will. Like I said, when you're enabled this much by a league, nothing's going to work in this case anymore when it comes to Draymond Green.
Well, it's one of those things that some people just need that to be fired up to play, and, you know, it doesn't make it right, but maybe that's part of it, is he can't get to the edge that he needs in the pros without doing that. But that also causes him problems. It's a very Rasheed Wallace problem.
Yes, very true. But at least Rasheed Wallace, like, actually had more to his game than just, like, beating up on players and punching people and maybe getting a dunk every once in a while and a defensive stop every once in a while.
Bringing you an in-depth look at Penn State sports and more. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. The Steve Jones Show is presented by NIL Game Changers, Sunbury Motor Company, Purdy Insurance, and Brewers Outlet. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
So I'm listening to that segment driving back from Quarterback Club, and even I wanted to drive off the road.
I have to remember not to wear earphones for that.
Hey, I mean, I hear the Draymond Green thing. We all get that he's not his type of player. Now, does he do things that are, in the moment, not America's most intelligent move? True. But has he brought value to the Warriors as to how he plays as a defender, a passer, a rebounder? Yeah, he has. I mean, he's perfect. Yeah. I mean, he's perfect. Was it something Draymond said?
I don't know if he did anything last night or not.
Okay.
I didn't see much NBA stuff last night, so. I do know. We talked a little bit. He did have Clay on his podcast this week, and ask him what Clay thought about when he got thrown out, and it was quite interesting because
when Clay got thrown out.
No, when he gets thrown out, and Clay goes through about how important he is to them, and right. When it happened the other week, and they kept showing Steph, and Steph said something. I think they've kind of reached their point with it too. That it's
that you do get to a point, yeah.
And I think that's part of the issue. I honestly think that's part of the issue with the Warriors the last 2 years is they don't know how to. They're kind of getting sick of his act, but they still need him, and it's a hard balancing act for him.
Well, there's also, look, they've kept the band together, the primary part, for as long as they can.
Yeah.
Okay. And the one thing, like, with him, this is where I think they've made a mistake. And again, this is going to sound cruel, but this is the way pro sports happens to be. It is a business. And in a business, the one thing that is tough for management to do is to be sentimental. And I think that's been, for the Warriors, it's been tough to get away from him. Because I think of sentimentality. He's been an important part of what they've done. And it's hard for them to let go. But they're older now as a team. They're competitive, but they're not good enough to win it. And also, you have to ask yourself what's the market for him out there? I mean, you're talking about a guy that's double digits now in terms of how long he's been in the league. I mean, what's the market for him out there? I think that's not a great market for him.
Well, and age is going to affect him more just because, he's a 6'6 post player, too. I mean, he needs his lift. He needs things like that. And, I mean, that's got to be going at this point. Yeah. Clay and Steph can kind of hold off Father Time a bit because they're guards and can stay out, can shoot so well. But right. I think he's going to have a little bit bigger problem holding off Father Time.
Hudson Ward is officially signed with Penn State basketball. The late signing period is underway. He is signed. He's out of Edmonton. Met his mom when they made the official visit here. Then actually watched him go out and, do some workout stuff. He already has the makings of a Big Ten body. He's a big wing, which is what Penn State needs. He has a nice shot. He's from Edmonton, so I've already kidded Jack Michaels, who's the voice of the Edmonton Oilers. He said, we stole one of your guys, and he's seen him play. I mean, Jack said he can play. And so he's been added in. Now, this is the blue-white weekend. You're going to have at least one guy considering Penn State on his transfer list in this weekend. At least one. It's more than that, we'll find out. But that's where they are with that. For Penn State football, I know they got another verbal today, and I can't get into the verbals. I can talk about Hudson Ward. He is signed for basketball. But I can't get into the verbal commitments for football. I can't talk about any of them until they actually sign. But obviously they did get a running back that committed to them today. There's also, I don't know how many recruits are in this weekend. I mean, you get to go into Beaver Stadium. There are going to be tens of thousands of people there. It's not going to rain, which is good. I mean, it's not going to be the warmest day, but it's not going to be the coldest day either. And so that's where it stands right now. I know Matt set the tone for the show.
It's the energy level was much lower this segment.
Well, you're saying I'm bringing the show down.
No, I'm saying you're a different vibe.
More logical common sense.
We'll go with mellower.
Mellower. Okay. There you go. And now, Scott Drew has turned down the any idea of interviewing at Kentucky. He's going to stay at Baylor. And I don't know what they're going to do. I mean, Danny Hurley has already looked out and said, no, I'm not going to do this. And Mitch Barnhart, who's the athletic director at Kentucky, I mean, he and Scott Drew are actually pretty close. But he likes Central Texas. Family likes Central Texas. And that's where they are. So he wants to stay in Waco. Of course, hey, how about Jay Wright? Jay's not going back to this. Danny Hurley? No. He's not leaving UConn. Billy Donovan? The Bulls are going to play in the play-in tournament. He says he's committed to the Bulls. Now, I realize it is it's a high-paying job. There's no question about that. It's a high-paying job. But as a pro coach, and who knows what his status with the Bulls is going to be, but my goodness, being a pro coach, there's a lot of elements that are very attractive to it, including I don't have to recruit, I don't have to worry about the transfer portal, and I don't have to worry about NIL. Those are all positives of a pro coach.
And an off-season.
Yeah, and an off-season. In the off-season, you're just, you know, whatever. You got a player personnel person, a general manager. They're taking care of all that stuff, you know, asking about it. So, now, names such as Bruce Pearl of Auburn. Right. And by the way, Nate Oates says he's not interested. Bruce Pearl at Auburn. Brad Underwood at Illinois. Sean Miller at Xavier. Todd Golden at Florida. T.J. Otzelberger with Iowa State. Mark Pope at BYU. All names showing up. It's interesting for a program that looked like they really wanted to cut ties with John Calipari. It doesn't seem like they had a post-Calipari plan. Because I thought by now it would be in place, right? They would have had somebody in mind out of the gate. And well, it seems like they don't.
I also feel like that they felt like they were Kentucky, and if they called, you know, whoever they called was going to drop whatever they were doing and take the job. And I think people are realizing that, you know, like, take Scott Drew. He's making $5 million a year. How much more money can Kentucky give him to, you know, take that pressure on? I mean, he can accomplish the same.
Excuse me. Hey. Have you ever gone by the corner office?
I have.
Right? Where the whole thing is pursuit of cash for that guy. There's not enough money in the world for him. Right? Not enough money. And he's made enough money off our talent so far.
I don't get NIL, though. Do you?
No, I don't. No, I don't get any NIL.
Hey, I'd take a used car at this point.
Well, I am very close to being in the market for a car. Like, I'm talking about, like, a few weeks.
Oh no,
it's I put together a plan in my own head that when I have my house paid off, that's when I would. It's not like the car is going to the heck in a handbasket. No, I've had it 12 years, but it's been a phenomenal car. But now I'm at that point. I finally reached that point. I'm like, okay, now we're going to start looking.
You're not getting a motorcycle, are you, Steve?
No, I'm not. The odds of me on a motorcycle are extremely long.
I assumed.
Extremely long. That is not going to happen. The pursuit of money. Well, that's not what makes everybody tick. If you're comfortable where you live, your family's happy, you're already, you know, he's getting $5 million. I mean, he didn't take a vow of poverty to stay at Baylor.
No.
Right?
No, and he can, you know, he's been successful there, and he's in the Big 12. You can probably accomplish just as much at Baylor at this point in 2024 as you can at Kentucky. Oh.
Well, he's won a national championship at Baylor, and the last time Kentucky won a national title was, 2014. I mean,
that's why I can't imagine one of the SEC coaches jumping over either, because, you know, they're already beating Kentucky for the most part.
Right. Yeah, I mean, you have to make your own decision as to what is comfortable in your life and where you are, and the alignment with your president, the alignment with your athletic director, your alignment with the boosters. If you already have all those ducks in a row and you're capable of winning it, right, or getting yourself in the mix to win it, why leave? Like, you know, like, let's take a guy whose name hasn't come up. But like, take Matt Painter. Matt Painter's been at Purdue 19 years, right? And they've been in the neighborhood of the Final Four a couple times. They finally broke through. They got there. Well, you know, that just tells everybody they can get there, right? Okay, they can get there. But Drew is, you know, Scott Drew has told Kentucky no, and that is where it stands. And that's okay. So now you go to the next guy. Meanwhile, in other Big Ten news, at least related to it, is Isaiah Collier is going to leave USC and he is going to the NBA draft. I mean, we have to start getting used to the idea of USC, UCLA, Washington, and Oregon news being Big Ten news that affects Penn State. Right? That's the way it is. All right, we do have to mention O.J. Simpson dying at the age of 76. And then we'll get to the Northwestern story, which is fascinating, about their stadium. And O.J. Simpson, we all know. I'll never forget being at the U.S. Open in 1994. I've told the story before. You know, Arnold Palmer walking up 18 for the final time at the U.S. Open, doing it at Oakmont, so close to La Trobe. Then him coming into the interview tent. I was standing in the last row of the interview tent. And, you know, they went through his round, and, you know, he doesn't make the cut. And they sit down, and the first question was from a woman in the front row, British accent, and says, you know, he says, "For years, you were the man. You put the tour on the map." And I mean, really, it was, you know, very complimentary question. She says, "What were your emotions as you walked up toward the green for the final time in your U.S. Open career?" And Earl Palmer attempted to answer it several times. Several times he attempted to answer. And he finally couldn't. He was just overcome with emotion of the whole thing. And he put the towel around his face, and he says, "I'm so sorry, I can't do this." And this guy has been always with the media, has been a gem. he got up and left, and all the media got up and gave him a standing ovation. So now I go back to the back of the tent. You know, and at this point, Jack Nicklaus was in contention, so I was able to get a nice one-on-one with him, which was really, I mean, terrific. Colin Montgomery was like, eh. It's like, okay. But a couple other guys. So I was able to put together a series of reports. While I'm doing it, I'm watching the white Bronco on TV. Like, you got to be kidding me. I'll never forget Chris Berman. Because, I mean, he was hosting on ESPN at the time. Comes back into the interview tent. And I just had finished something. So I was standing there looking at it. And he goes, can you believe this? Right? And then somebody else, I think it was Jimmy Roberts, came over and knew him a little bit. And he says, what's going on here? He says, I guess that's him laying in the back seat. Well, I drove all the way back home that night. And, of course, it was a slow chase. And he finally pulled into the driveway when I pulled into my driveway. And I got out of the car and I go in and I'm watching. And, like, he's just pulling in. I'm like, oh, you got to be kidding me. He's like, it took that long? And I drove all the way back from Oakmont to State College. We all know about the trial. And what happened with the trial and the not guilty verdict. Watch the not guilty verdict in the Penn State media room. Because it happened in the middle of the day. Joe was already in there. Everybody kind of stopped to watch it. And found not guilty. So we know about that. As a football player, I remember watching him at USC on TV in the Rose Bowl. Wow. Electric. Fast. Great moves. Could cut. Watching with the Bills. To me, I remember talking to Jack. The Bills, the one year they made the playoffs with him, they beat the Steelers in the regular season. And O.J. got to the edge and then took off on a long 80-plus yard run. And, of course, the guy that was on the edge who was supposed to cover it up was Jack. And, I mean, Jack's told me this story like four or five times. He goes, I can't believe I didn't get, he says, I still to this day, I can't believe I didn't get the angle on that. And then when they played in the playoffs, the Steelers beat them handily. 2,000 yards, he did it. 2,003 yards, he did it in a 14-game season. And it just, you know, you want to talk about everything to that point. He'd been on TV. He really was considered to be, wow, O.J. Simpson. And then that happened, and everything about O.J. Simpson and his, what people thought of him changed dramatically. All right. We'll take a break. I apologize for bringing the temperature down on the show.
Not that far down.
But I do have to talk about this Northwestern story. This is interesting about where they're going to play their home games, at least most of them. Not all, but most. We'll talk about that in a moment. This half hour brought to you by Purdy Insurance. Market Street in Sunbury, go to purdyinsurance.com. Auto, home, life, business, boat, motorcycle, RV. Customer service means everything to them. They're just outstanding. They care about you. You're not a number. They just want to take care of your needs and save you money, because each individual that needs insurance and works with Purdy is important. On News Radio 1070, WKOK.
There's something to be said about a sale with a handshake. A service technician who really knows what he's doing, they can explain it in English what the problem is. There's nothing better than having that friend you could trust in the area. That's Sunbury Motors, where you get selection, knowledgeable salespeople, and prices that fit your budget, and more important, that friend you can trust. Welcome to Sunbury Motors, Kia, Ford, and Hyundai. You could shop other dealers and compare prices, but at Sunbury Motors, you get their lowest price promise. They research the current used vehicle market it and guarantee their used car prices are the lowest. If you find a lower price, Sunbury Motors will beat it. Three dealers all in one. See their full new and pre-owned inventory at sunburymotors.com. Pick out a vehicle you like and schedule your test drive online. Follow them on Facebook. Sunbury Motors Ford and Hyundai, North 4th Street, Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf.
You want a unique way to display your brand. You need a team of seasoned experts to work with. You want to reach customers who buy. You want NIL Game Changers, a versatile consulting agency powered by former student athletes and coaches who work as NIL sports agents. NIL Game Changers will help you build powerful relationships with customers through compelling stories, with student athlete influencers as your leading edge. Finally, we'll equip you with the right media to drive your success home. NILGameChangers.org, building meaningful relationships with your customers.
It's time to put your best foot forward for some warm weather fun. First, visit Mifflinburg Variety, your family footwear store. They have all the popular names like New Balance, Saucony, Wolverine, Timberland Pro, Under Armour, and plenty more. Mifflinburg Variety has all the equipment you need for outdoor fun, like camping, fishing and hunting gear, and sporting equipment from Outdoor Research, Marmot, Remington, and Winchester. There's kitchen and household items by Cuisinart and Hamilton Beach. Plus, they carry toys and gifts by Melissa and Doug, Ertl, and lots more. All at Mifflinburg Variety, your family's variety store. In the Buffalo Valley Shopping Center, Mifflinburg. What?
So where did Cotrello record that YMCA thing? On his cell phone in the basement?
It does sound pretty far away, doesn't it?
Oh. Okay.
He hollered out the window to a microphone.
Come on out to the YMCA.